Why is Preppy telling me about the parameters when I subscribe to their channel to know about how to write the letter and the essay? So here is the reason why. If you saw a philosophy video, if you watched it and if you understood it, you would get to know that there are some subjective tests, which are the writing and the speaking, which are assessed on some parameters. These are those parameters on which you are assessed, and these are the parameters which you will have to fulfill to get the desired band score. Writing whatever comes to your mind and expressing it, even if you express it flawlessly, it doesn't matter unless you address each one of these parameters. So that is what is important, and not the content or ideas. Yes, without the content you cannot write, you cannot complete 150 word limit or the 250 word limit, but content is not all that you need. You need to know the parameters on which you're going to be assessed. Okay, these are the parameters. There's basically a blueprint, there's basically a booklet that the examiner has. They'll tally your answers with those booklet points and they'll mark you accordingly. So you need to understand each one of these parameters, and that is what we are going to do in this video. So once you understand, the following lectures would have the enhancer series. Each of these would be explained and we'll help you enhance each of these parameters in the subsequent videos. So let's move ahead. First parameter on which your writing is assessed, we are talking particularly about the writing today. Speaking would be dealt later on. So in the writing, what are you assessed on? Task achievement or task response. The task achievement is in the case of a letter, whereas task response is in the case of an essay. Okay, there's a slight difference between the two. We'll deal with it later on. Second one is coherence and cohesion. How coherent is your essay or letter? How connected is it? Grammatical range and accuracy. I don't have to explain this. Your grammar has to be in the right place. Lexical resources, basically your vocabulary. How good is your vocabulary? How wide is your range of vocabulary? That is what matters here. Now, one thing that is of utmost importance is that each of these parameters carry the same weightage. So each of them has a weightage of 25%. So you cannot dare to ignore any one of them. Even if you achieve the task at hand, for example, the letter has 3 bullet points, you have addressed all the 3 bullet points, but you have ignored the lexical resources, for example, then you lose on these 25% of lexical resource bands. Okay, so you don't have to do that. You have to cater to one of these parameters and ace IELTS test by scoring well in each one of them and acing all the 25% weightage, right? So focus equally on each of these 4 parameters. So when you incorporate all the 4 parameters in one letter and one essay, the wholesome answer that you get in the end gets you the desired band score, which is above 7 at least, or 7.5 if I might say. Okay, so let's understand what each of these parameters have in hold for you. Let's move on to the very first parameter on which your writing would be assessed, which is the task achievement in case of task 1, that is your letter. So these are the 4 factors on which your task achievement is assessed. Number 1, reason of writing the letter, addressing all bullet points, using accurate tone, and adhering to the word limit. Let's focus on each one of them individually. Number 1, reason of writing the letter. You're given a letter and you have to write that letter. There's supposed to be a reason behind writing the letter. You just don't randomly write a letter to a friend or an official. There's a reason. There's a reason why you're writing the letter, and that reason has to be clear while you're writing the letter, so that as soon as somebody opens your letter, they're clear that you have written it for some XYZ reason. Number 2, addressing all bullet points. If you're familiar with the questions that come in IELTS, you will understand that there are 3 bullet points in every letter type, in every letter question. So these 3 bullet points have to be addressed. each of the bullet point has to be addressed by you, only then will you fulfill this particular factor. Number three, use accurate tone. As we all know, there are three types of letters, which are formal, semi-formal and informal. So all these three letters have a different tone. While you're writing a formal letter to an official, you use formal language. You don't use friendly or casual language as you do with a friend in case of an informal letter. So you need to be very particular about the usage of your tone. Okay, so it has to be accurate in nature. Then adhere to the word limit. So your letters are supposed to be 150 words. It has to comprise of 150 words at least. So you have to write at least 150 words, only then will you be scored good in your task achievement parameter. Writing even one word less than 150 words would cause you a penalty, which we do not want, right? So focus on writing more than 150 words, but manage to end your letter by 160 or at the most 170 words. Okay, so let's recap. We have to write the reason of writing the letter, address all the three bullet points that are mentioned in the letter question, and use accurate tone as per the type of letter we are writing, and ultimately write more than 150 words. I repeat, this is the silliest mistake that you can make on your writing test, which is not adhering to the word limit. So adhere to the word limit, write at least 150 words. Next is your task response in case of essay writing. This also carries a weightage of 25%. Respond to all parts of the question, explain ideas, develop and justify them with examples, and write at least 250 words. So it's pretty similar to the task achievement. In this, you have to respond to all parts of the question, be it telling your opinion, whether you agree or disagree, advantages and disadvantages and your opinion. So things like that, you have to focus on what the question is asking you, what the topic is asking you to do, and address that particular thing. So you have to respond to all parts of the question. The question might have three parts, so you have to address to each one of them. It might have two parts, just disadvantages and advantages. So address both those parts. Focus on this. Don't miss out on any part that your question asks you to do. Next is explain ideas, develop them, and justify your stance with example. So you give them an idea. You have to develop that idea, okay? Don't just write a single statement. You have to develop on it and then justify that stance. Justify your stance. Why do you think that is true? With examples. Even if you write one example, it's more than enough. So your idea is supported by an example which justifies why you think that the above statement is true or false, right? Ultimately, the last point here is to adhere to the word limit, which is to write at least 250 words. And the same rule applies here as well, which is to write more than 250 words. Writing even one word less than 250 words would cause you a penalty, which we do not want to happen. So let's focus on writing more than 250 words, but don't exceed more than 270 words, because doing so, you wouldn't be able to wind up your answer within the time limit of 40 minutes. So we want to adhere to the time limit as well as the word limit. So write approximately around 250 to 270 words and try to conclude your essay within 40 minutes. So this is about your task achievement and task response. Pause the video here, have a look at it again and see if you have practiced before this. Have you catered to these things? If not, you have the answer why you haven't scored the desired band score. It's because you have not fulfilled the very first parameter, which is your task achievement or task response. Let's move on to the second parameter, which is coherence and cohesion. So what is coherence? Coherence is the logical sequencing of ideas. Be it any kind of writing, you have to put in your ideas on paper, and this is supposed to be in a proper sequence stage wise, so that as the person is reading, they understand the transition of your writing well. So how would you put your ideas into a proper sequence? It can be done by writing it in a structured manner. First of all, this is a prototype. This is the most common way of structuring your writing, which is, first of all, write an introduction. You write your introduction, you introduce your entire essay, what will be the crux of it, what would you mention in the following writing. In the first paragraph, you introduce the first idea. In the second paragraph, you introduce the second idea, and then you finally conclude it. If need be, you can add another body paragraph here, which would be body paragraph 3. So this is how you structure your answer, and once you structure your answers, you would automatically sequence your ideas well. Next thing is, do not write abrupt ideas. Your ideas should have a link with each other. The first idea and second idea should have something in common and should not be something very random and abrupt. Okay? Moving on to cohesion. Cohesion is how well you connect your ideas and paragraphs. So you're writing one set of ideas in paragraph 1 and the other set of ideas in paragraph 2. There is supposed to be a link between these two, right? That link is achieved with cohesion by using connectors. So when you link two paragraphs or say two sentences or two ideas with connectors, it enhances your cohesion. So that is what we have to do, and what are connectors would be dealt in the following lectures. Now I'll just give you a few examples of connectors, which are however, moreover, nonetheless, and other such linkers or connectors are used to enhance the cohesion in your writing. Next, you need to be very particular that you use them only when it's required. Do not use them unnecessarily. So the connectors are important, and you must have attended many coaching classes or heard from your friends that you should use connectors to enhance the score or the band score in your writing. But just putting words like however, moreover, unnecessarily and thinking that it would enhance your band score is wrong. That is not how it works. You have to use them appropriately, only then they increase your band score, not just putting it randomly in your essay. Okay, so this is your coherence and cohesion. It basically means that you have ideas in your essays which are in proper sequence, and those sequences properly linked with each other through connectors. So this is about coherence and cohesion. Yet again, these carry 25% of your weightage, so you cannot ignore them, just like task achievement or the other three parameters. Let's move on to the third parameter, which is grammatical range and accuracy. So what does it consist of? Appropriate use of tenses, voices, punctuations, comparatives, and use of different types of sentences. So grammatical range and accuracy basically assess your accurate usage of grammar. So you have to use grammar accurately to score well in this particular parameter. The common mistakes that I find when I assess or evaluate your answers is in case of tenses, where the most common mistake is using the second form of the verb with did. Did you went for a movie? What is the mistake in this particular sentence? If you cannot find out the mistake in this sentence, then I must say you should work on your tenses. Okay? So what is the issue with this sentence? When we use a sentence in which we have did, so we use the first form of the verb and not the second form of the verb. Okay? So, did you go for a movie is the correct grammatical sentence, rather than saying did you went for a movie. Okay? So it's never did you went. You use the first form of the verb, which is go. Did you go for the movie? Okay? So avoid making such silly mistakes when it comes to tenses. What about voices? Voices are of two types, active and passive. Okay? If you incorporate both of these types of voices in your writing, it enhances the grammatical range. It enhances the range of your grammar. So it gives value to your writing. So if you can, you must use both these types of voices. Coming to punctuations. Punctuations, what are punctuations? Full stop, commas, semicolon, colon, these are punctuations. What is the significance of these tiny, tiny symbols? They might seem very tiny and might seem irrelevant, but when it comes to their usage in English language, they can change the meaning of the entire sentence if they are used at the wrong place. Full stop means a sentence is ending somewhere, okay? After you complete a sentence, you put a full stop. That means you have concluded that sentence. When it comes to comma, that means your sentence has not ended yet, but you have taken a pause. So comma basically is a pause in your sentence. You have taken a pause, okay? So if you use a full stop instead of a comma, it would change the meaning of the entire sentence. So you have to be very careful while using punctuations. Use them at relevant places. Don't use them unnecessarily and don't even miss out on them, because if you miss out on them, it might change the meaning of the sentence. Comparatives. What are comparatives? Comparatives are the words that are used to compare nouns. For example, tall, taller, tallest. These are called comparative words. So he is taller than me. Okay, so taller here compares two people. So one is taller than the other. He is the tallest of them all. So he's the tallest among all the people. So that means we are comparing nouns here. Ultimately, to enhance your band score in this particular parameter, which is grammatical range and accuracy, you have to use different types of sentences. If you use a combination of complex and simple sentences, it will add value to your answer. There are different types of sentences. The ones which are simple, just there's a one fact stated in the sentence, they are called simple sentences. Then we have exclamatory sentences, which end with an exclamation mark, and then we have interrogative, and interrogative sentences are the ones which end with a question mark, and then we have complex sentences. Okay, so these are the different kinds of sentences which we can use in our essays as well as our letters. So summing it up, if you incorporate all these factors in your parameters, you would score a perfect 25% in this particular parameter. I hope I'm clear. So let's move on to the next parameter. Let's move on to the very last parameter on which your writing is assessed, which is the lexical resources. The lexical resources have four factors under it, which are vocabulary, spellings, use of appropriate collocations, and use of accurate tone. Let's deal with each one of them individually. So first of all, vocabulary. You just have task 1 and task 2 in your writing, which is 150 words plus 250 words to showcase the wide range of vocabulary that you have. So utilize this limited word limit to showcase as much range as you can in case of your vocabulary. Use synonyms. Try to avoid using repetitive words. Change your words. Do not use the same words again and again. Okay? So replace common words with uncommon and impressive and different words. Okay? Next, coming to spellings. Your spellings should be correct. Do not make silly mistakes. One very common spelling mistake is grammar. What is the spelling of grammar? G-R-A-M-M-E-R. No, it's not E here, it's an A. Okay, so make sure you don't make such silly mistakes. When it comes to use of appropriate collocations, collocations are basically the use of the right verb with a noun. For example, you don't give an exam, you take an exam. So, giving an exam is a wrong sentence. You instead take an exam or taking an exam. So, what do you say? I took my IELTS test yesterday, instead of saying that I gave my IELTS test yesterday. Okay? So, make sure you don't make such mistakes in your collocations. Collocations, another example of collocations would be there is heavy traffic. Okay? You don't say there is hard traffic or there is too much traffic. You use heavy traffic. You need to use an appropriate verb with the noun, which is traffic. Okay? Next is the use of accurate tone. In all your writings except for the informal letter, you have to use formal tone and a formal language. So, the usage of words should be formal in nature except for in your informal letter. So, be it any kind of essay, your formal letter or your semi-formal letter, you must not use casual and friendly language. You should use formal tone. Okay, that's about it with the lexical resources. Your vocabulary is very important. None of your examiners would be happy to see silly spelling mistakes in your writing. So, make sure your spellings are also right. Collocations should be appropriate and should be thought after when you're writing your answers. And ultimately, your tone should be right. You cannot talk in a friendly manner to a manager, and you cannot be very formal with your friends. So, you need to make sure that you are informal in case of an informal letter, but you're formal in all the other writing tasks. Now that we have dealt with all the four parameters, let's understand the importance of these parameters through an example. So, consider your IELTS examiner or the one who evaluates your writing to be a doctor, okay? Let's associate that he or she is a doctor. Now, when you go to a doctor and ask them to check your health, does the doctor immediately say after seeing your face that you're healthy? They don't do that. Similarly, your IELTS examiner wouldn't just look at your answer and say that this should be given 8 bands, right? There are some parameters on which the doctor will evaluate you. Similarly, there are some parameters on which your IELTS examiner will evaluate your writing. The doctor evaluates you based on your blood test, your urine test or other such tests, and then gives the report whether you're healthy or not. Similarly, in case of IELTS, the IELTS examiner assesses you on these four parameters: your task achievement, your coherence and cohesion, grammatical range and accuracy, and lastly your lexical resources. So, these are the parameters, or the scorecard you get on these parameters decides whether you will get a good band score above 7 or 8 or would you get something below that. So, this is how they will decide whether you have a healthy English or not. So, you have to understand that the IELTS examiner is looking at these parameters while they are assessing your answers. So, if you don't give them value on these particular parameters, if you don't provide them with vocabularies, proper spellings, collocations or accurate tone, for example, in case of lexical resources, you would sound unhealthy in this parameter. So, make sure you give them what they want, what they're looking for. If your IELTS examiner is looking for task achievement, provide them with task achievement, okay? So, understand that each of these four parameters carry equal weightage, which is 25%. So, value each one of them equally, cater to each of the requirements of these parameters, and I guarantee you that the IELTS examiner would not be able to reduce even a single mark of yours. So, focus on it, okay? These are the parameters, and now let's come to how we will help you at Prep Eve. Now that you have understood parameters matter, we'll help you enhance each of these parameters. We will come up with an enhancer series for each of these parameters. From tomorrow, we'll begin with the task achievement enhancer series, in which we'll help you out understand how can you address each of the task that is to be addressed to score good bands in case of task achievement. We'll help you do that in form of three letters. We'll take all the three types of letters, which is formal, informal and semi-formal, help you out deal with the tasks of each one of them and score good when it comes to task achievement. So first we'll pick the very first parameter, then we'll come to the second, third and fourth parameter in the subsequent series, and with examples. Everything is practical in our course. So with examples, we'll help you understand each of the parameters, and with those examples, practically you'll understand how do you address each of the factors under those parameters. For example, if I take, since this is already written, I'll just give you the example of lexical resources. In case of the lexical resources enhancer series, in the first lecture of that series, we'll tell you how you can enhance your vocabulary, how you can use synonyms and enhance the range of your vocabulary in your writing, okay? In the second lecture, we'll tell you the common spelling mistakes that people make or how you can avoid making spelling mistakes. In the third lecture, we'll tell you about the appropriate use of collocations and how to use them in your essays. In the fourth lecture, we'll tell you the accurate tone. So when I say 1, 2, 3, 4 lectures, that doesn't mean that this would have only one lecture. The vocabulary would be divided further on the basis of topics, right? Each topic would have vocabulary for it. For example, the topic is environment. We'll give you vocabulary, we'll give you words for that particular topic. So it would be topic based vocabulary here, and then we'll give you spelling mistakes as well. So this is how our course would go, and this is how we'll cater to each and every parameter. Now that you've understood this, you've understood how our course would be, I would request you to go to our website, which is prepeve.com. Go there. This course is absolutely free. It is available for you anytime you want to watch it. You can watch it on our YouTube channel. But if you are in a hurry, if your exam is approaching and you have to take your test in say 1 or 2 months and you don't have sufficient time to watch each of our videos on YouTube, I would suggest you to go to our website, see the personalized guidance course that we have for you. We charge for this service. So you can avail it if you want to, if you like our philosophy, if you understand the importance of parameters, because we would be following this strategy even in our one-on-one courses, which are paid. So yes, these are paid. We don't hide anything. We don't want to deceive you. The entire course on YouTube is free. But apart from that, if you want to avail the one-on-one guidance course, that's chargeable. Before you go, let me tell you, I'll be giving you an exercise every day. So today's exercise is to take a recap of this video again, go through the parameters one more time, and whatever you understand, write that down in the comment section below, okay? Even if you have absorb like 25% of it, doesn't matter. Just go down and write down in the comment section and review again. In our series, we'll make it further clear if you have any doubts on any of these parameters. So don't you worry about it. I'm really overwhelmed with the response that I've got from you. Thank you so much for staying with us, waiting for 1st of May. I know 1st of May was like, I don't know what was going to happen on 1st of May. You guys are lovely, lovely, lovely people. Thank you so much for giving so much importance to our course and liking our philosophy. Stay tuned with us. We won't disappoint you, and we promise you to deliver the best quality content you'll ever find for IELTS on YouTube. Thank you so much.